Did the U.S. get duped by a shadowy Russian? A new report in the New York Times claims American spies paid a Russian man $100,000 after he claimed to have hacking tools or cybersecurity weapons stolen from the NSA, along with compromising material on President Trump. The man, however, never handed these materials over. According to the paper, the American spies agreed to pay the Russian $1 million for the intel. And they were serious about the offer. At one point, the U.S. spies gave the man $100,000 in a briefcase as an installment. And according to the Times, the NSA even used its official Twitter account to send coded messages to the Russian nearly a dozen times. But the U.S. spies soon had doubts. The paper writes, his apparent eagerness to sell the Trump kompromat, a Russian term for information used to gain leverage over someone, to American spies raised suspicions among officials that he was part of an operation to feed the information to United States intelligence agencies and pit them against Mr. Trump. There were other questions about the Russian's reliability. He had a history of money laundering and a thin legitimate cover business, a nearly bankrupt company that sold portable grills for street-side sausage salesmen, according to British corporation papers. Now, the American spies ended up chasing this Russian out of Western Europe and warning him to never come back. I want to bring in the man behind this new reporting, national security correspondent for the New York Times, Matthew Rosenberg. Matthew, I have so many questions for you about this story, but apparently first, your reporting caught the attention of the president, and he tweeted this about your report today. According to the New York Times, a Russian sold phony secrets on Trump to the U.S. asking price was $10 million, brought down to $1 million to be paid over time. I hope people are now seeing and understanding what is going on here. It is all now starting to come out. Drain the swamp. Is this an accurate characterization of your reporting, Matthew?
It's not. It's not. Look, this is a complicated story. I think that's pretty clear here. The Americans were out looking for this kind of vast trove of hacking tools, of cyber weapons that had been stolen from the NSA and the CIA. And the idea here, they weren't going to take it off the market or get them back. They were just trying to figure out what was missing, what was already out there in the wild and what they had to worry about, because they didn't even know exactly what had gotten out. And they find this Russian who says, I can give you everything. And they're like, great, we can maybe start unraveling this mystery. But then the Russian says, but you know what? We're going to have to include this material on President Trump. I want to throw that in there. And the Americans didn't really want that. They made it clear to the Russian, we want the cyber weapons. Don't sell us the other stuff. The Russian.
So tell us more.
Yeah.
Tell us more, because I want to just unpack this first before you go further. They wanted the cyber weapons that had been stolen. So tell us about the guy who claimed to have these cyber weapons. What more do we know about him?
So the Russian who I interviewed multiple times in Europe, he's this fixer of sorts for Russian intelligence. He has connections to very senior Russian intelligence people, but he also has some underworld connections as well. He's done some money laundering. He's moved some semi-precious metals around Europe for Russian oligarchs. He's a kind of hard guy to figure out, and that's one of the problems here when dealing with counterintelligence in Russia, is that the difference between a Russian intelligence officer and an organized crime figure is often very, very blurry. And it makes it very hard to figure out, well, who's who and what are we dealing with here?
And at one point, a meeting happened inside the Russian embassy in Berlin. So does the U.S. believe this man was being supported by the Russian government?
They suspect it was the case.
So how did this then play out? How did the deal actually work? If they thought he was kind of a shady character, and yet they did end up handing him $100,000, break it down.
Well, I think, you know, spies deal with shady characters. It's kind of the nature of the business. And one of the things you do there is you kind of say, okay, does this guy have what we think he has? Can we verify he's with who we think he's with? And, you know, they ran the checks on that. The $100,000 payment was meant as a down payment. Let's see what you got, and then we'll give you more. It's why you don't give him $1 million up front. They gave him $100,000, and then that was in September last year. And then he began delivering documents and material, data. There were bank records, emails, purported Russian intelligence documents about mostly Mr. Trump, his associates, and the election. Now, I think it's important to note, this material's never been assessed. It's been left with an intermediary the Americans used to do the negotiations. This person has it secured in Europe, where it's sitting there kind of unassessed and unverified.
And your reporting suggests, and you alluded to this earlier, that the U.S. intelligence officials were very reluctant to even accept this dirt on President Trump, period.
Yes. I mean, look, I think anybody who's in the CIA, the NSA, any of American intelligence agencies will tell you they do not go out and spy on Americans. They're not going out to look for material on Americans. If somebody comes to them with something of real counterintelligence value that shows that an American is working as an agent of a foreign power, yeah, and then yes, they're interested. But I don't think anybody was sure that this met that standard, and that, you know, the politics in Washington being what they are right now, you can understand why somebody at the CIA or the NSA would say, you know, no thank you, we want no part of this.
When we talk about the NSA tweeting in code to this Russian, and again, some of the details of your reporting, it sounds a little bit like out of a movie. How unusual is deal making like this?
I don't entirely know for sure. I mean, I don't think it's an everyday occurrence. I don't think it's wildly unusual either, having spoken to people who were involved and people who used to do this kind of work. It's complicated, and you are dealing in a world where everybody is duplicitous and everybody is trying to kind of hide something or sneak something around or sell something that doesn't belong to them. And so that does lend itself to a kind of movie-like setup where you've got, you know, social media messages sent to send signals. You've got kind of meetings in weird little bars and weird little cities in the middle of Europe. I mean, this is the world they live in.
Your reporting also seems to confirm some of the details in which Russia is still trying to sow doubt and discord in American institutions.
You know, I think that's what the intelligence community believes is still happening. You looked at some of the kind of very partisan hashtags that have kind of pick up steam on Twitter, and there's some evidence or a lot of evidence that's coming out of bot networks based in Eastern Europe and Russia. We've had a number of officials in recent weeks say they think that there are attempts to kind of penetrate American voter systems unfolding, much like there were before the 2016 election. And you know, I think we're living in a world where it's very easy to kind of stir up partisan passions in Washington. And you see that when, you know, two Russian spy chiefs are in Washington, they meet with the director of the CIA to talk about counterterrorism. And that gets leaked by the Russians themselves because they know that that's gonna cause dissension, that's gonna cause arguments. And I think that's the view right now, is that that's what the Russians are trying to accomplish here.
Matthew Rosenberg, really great reporting. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.